Hello everyone, now let us discuss about drug therapy in myocardial infarction. So, first of all, what are acute coronary syndromes, ACS? The term ACS refers to chest pain with or without myocardial infarction, which is nothing but myocardial necrosis. And the latter, that is myocardial infarction, diagnosis is essentially based on the presence or absence of increase in plasma levels of cardiac troponin 1, I or T. So the ACS, they usually result from reduction or blockade of blood flow to heart. It is often caused by plaque rupture or clot formation in heart arteries, mainly coronary arteries. The symptoms are chest pain and discomfort, pain or discomfort in one or both arms, and the pain radiates to jaw, neck, back, or even stomach, shortness of breath, dizziness, nausea, and sweating. Coming to the types, according to the severity, the acute coronary syndromes may be graded into unstable angina, non-ST segment elevated myocardial infarction, and ST segment elevated myocardial infarction. Coming to unstable angina, here the vascular obstruction is incomplete and the myocardial necrosis is absent. And similarly, the biochemical markers do not appear in the blood and ST segment is also not elevated in the ECG. When it comes to NSTEMI, that is non-ST segment elevated myocardial infarction, here the vascular obstruction is incomplete but partially thick. The myocardial necrosis in small area can be seen and the biochemical markers appear in the blood. But the ST segment is not elevated in the ECG. Hence, it is called non-ST segment elevated myocardial infarction. Coming to ST segment elevated myocardial infarction, here the vascular obstruction is complete, myocardial necrosis in a larger area of myocardium is seen and the biochemical markers in the blood are prominent and ST segment is elevated in the ECG. However, unstable angina and non-ST segment elevated myocardial infarction may progress to ST segment elevated myocardial infarction. This is an important point. Now, coming to myocardial infarction is ischemic necrosis of a portion of myocardium due to sudden occlusion of branch of coronary artery. And the usual cause is acute thrombus at the site of atherosclerotic obstruction. Coming to the types, they are transmural infraction, where complete occlusion occurs and the infraction extends through the whole thickness of the heart muscle. The next one is subendocardial infraction. It involves occlusion in small areas in the subendocardial wall of left ventricle and ventricular septum. Coming to the risk factors, there are mainly two risk factors, non-modifiable factors and modifiable factors. The non-modifiable factors are age, gender, and family history, whereas the modifiable factors are conditions such as stress, hypertension, high lipid levels, smoking, physical activity, obesity, and diabetes mellitus. The modified factors can be rectified, whereas the non-modifiable factors cannot be changed. Coming to the pathophysiology, the first step is atherosclerosis of coronary artery. This leads to narrowing of lumen and finally this results in decreased blood flow and increased oxygen demand, which leads to hypoxia in the myocardium. And finally, this results in necrosis or cell death, which is characterized by inflammation, that is fever, stimulation of pain, vital capacity and somatic nervous system, which results in increased heart rate and cold sweat and release of troponin and cytokinin MD. Coming to the effects of myocardial infarction, the cardiopulmonary effects are systolic or diastolic dysfunction, decreased cardiac output, tachycardia, arrhythmias, dysapnea, and pulmonary congestion or edema. And the effects of systemic vasculature are increased systemic vascular resistance and increased systemic edema. And the neurohumoral effects are sympathetic activation, which leads to increase in circulatory catecholamines, angiotensin II and aldosterone, natriuretic peptides, arginine and vasopressin or antidiuretic hormone. Coming to diagnosis, the myocardial infarction can be diagnosed by ECG, cardiac markers, angiography, and chest X-ray. Coming to the management of myocardial infarction, the drug therapy in myocardial infarction has following objectives. The first one is to reduce pain, anxiety, and apprehension. The second is oxygenation. Third is maintenance of blood volume, tissue perfusion, and microcirculation, or correction of acidosis. Next one is prevention and treatment of arrhythmias, management of cardiac output, prevention of thrombus extension, embolism, venous thrombosis, etc., and thrombolysis and reperfusion. Next is prevention of remodeling and subsequent congestive heart failure, and finally prevention of further attacks. These are some of the objectives in the management. Each patient may have a different clinical objective. First one, coming to reduce pain, anxiety, and apprehension. In order to reduce pain, anxiety, and apprehension, glycerin trinitrate, 3 doses, 5 minutes apart are given. If pain is not relieved, an opioid analgesic such as morphine or diazepam is administered parenterally. And in order to increase oxygenation, oxygen inhalation and assisted respiration is given. The next one is maintenance of blood volume, tissue perfusion, and microcirculation. In order to maintain the blood volume, tissue perfusion, and microcirculation, slow IV infusion of saline or dextrose is given. And in order to correct the acidosis, which occurs due to lactic acid production, it is corrected by sodium bicarbonate infusion. And next one is prevention and treatment of arrhythmias. The beta blockers are used in evolving myocardial infarction, which reduces the infarct size and subsequent complications. The tachyarrhythmias are treated with lidocaine, IV lidocaine, procainamide, or amiodarone. And the bradycardia and heart block are treated by giving atropine or electrical pacing. The next one is management of cardiac output. The main objective is to increase the cardiac output and decrease the filling pressure. The drugs are furosemide, used if pulmonary wedge pressure is less than 20 mmHg. It decreases the cardiac preload. And similarly, vasodilators like GTN, slow IV is used, and it is supplemented by IV esmolol or labetalol. The next one is ionotrophic agents are also given to increase the pumping action of heart. Dopamine or dobutamine IV infusion may be needed. Coming to the prevention of thrombus extension, embolism, and venous thrombosis. Here, aspirin 162 to 325 mg should be given for chewing and swallowing as soon as the myocardial infarction is suspected. Alternate add-on antiplatelet drugs may be given like clopidogrel, prasugrel, and ticagrelol. And next, the anticoagulants are used primarily to prevent DVT and pulmonary or systemic arterial embolism. DVT is nothing but deep venous thrombosis, and to prevent the pulmonary or systemic arterial embolism. And the effect is usually short term. The next one is thrombolysis and reperfusion. In order to achieve thrombolysis and reperfusion, fibrinolytic agents such as plasminogen activators are used to achieve reperfusion of infarcted areas. Altiplase and tenactiplase are indicated in only ST segment elevated myocardial infarction or high risk non-ST segment elevated myocardial infarction. PCI with stunning is now preferred revascularization procedure. The next one is prevention of remodeling and subsequent congestive heart failure. AC inhibitors or angiotensin receptor antagonists have proven effective and long-term survival benefits. They should be started as soon as the patient is hemodynamically stable. The next one is prevention of further attacks. In order to prevent the further attacks, platelet inhibitors like aspirin or clopidogrel is given on long-term basis. Beta blockers are also given. These drugs reduce the risk of reinfarction, congestive heart failure, and mortality, and can be used for at least 2 years, if not contraindicated. And next one is control of hyperlipidemia. Dietary substitutes with unsaturated fats, hypolipidemic drugs, especially statins, are routinely prescribed. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe for further videos on pharmacology and other related pharmaceutical sciences.